I'm Howard Teach. I'm the founder of the Manhattan Jewish Historical Initiative, and we want to welcome all of you to this, what I call, a great evening of legends. You don't have Joe Berger, Gabe Pressman, and Ruth Messinger and not think of it that way. It's extraordinary for us. We call it Great Jewish Stories, the Miracle of the New York Jewish Experience. And I want you to think in terms of what we've created as a civilization in New York, in terms of the Jewish community, the Jewish history. This is a miracle. We haven't had as many times with the kind of freedom that we have, the kinds of accomplishment we've had, the people that we've had who've done unbelievable things both locally and throughout the world. And we can compare it to practically anything. That's the reason for the Manhattan Jewish Historical Initiative. The world should know. We should know. And there never was a populist history put together of the Jewish community. That's what this is about. So tonight is the first of a series that you'll have of some of the leading people of New York talking about their experience in the Jewish community, remembrances they have. This will be for posterity. This project is a 100-year project starting now. Maybe it'll go 1,000, maybe it'll go 5,000. But it certainly isn't going to end anytime soon.
This opportunity to document Manhattan Jewish history is very exciting, and to have SAJ be part of it is very significant, because SAJ is the very first Reconstructionist synagogue in the country, which was a movement, the only movement that was born in the United States of the four Jewish movements. And this, where you are sitting tonight, is the location of the very first bat mitzvah to ever happen in the history of Judaism, of a female being called to the Torah to have a bat mitzvah and celebrate girls as equally as boys, is this very location. So we're excited to be a synagogue that has this rich history and to share it with this initiative and with everyone here tonight, and really appreciate you coming out and welcome so much to the SAJ. Thanks.
So in 1939, my grandfather, who was a rabbi in Cologne, like so many others, had to flee, and was actually Congregation B'nai Jeshurun that sponsored him and my grandmother and my mother to come here, and they settled on the Upper West Side. The courage that he and so many others displayed in creating a brand new life here is never far from my mind, and that to me is a legacy that he and so many other German Jews and Jews from other places in Europe, their fighting spirit, and that's imbued me with faith and with desire to help people, which is why I'm in public office. A deep faith-based desire to push for progressive values is a trait shared by many Jews, instilled in them by generations before them who struggled just to survive. And in my almost 10 years in office, those are the values I've relied upon each and every day when I make important policy decisions, and as well as when I help constituents, whether it's someone fighting a landlord who's taking advantage of them, helping the elderly. These are all values that were instilled in me by the previous generation, the people who populated the Upper West Side, where I grew up. When we reflect on our shared history, so much of the Jewish narrative is mired in suffering and oppression. But so much of it is also rooted in perseverance and the will and capacity to overcome. I, like many Jews, see parallels between our historic fights and the persecution we faced and the current vitriolic rhetoric overshadowing our national politics. Because of Jews' history of oppression and persecution, I feel strongly that we as Jews across New York and the country have a moral obligation and responsibility to stand beside people who are being singled out for persecution as a result of their deeply held religious beliefs. As we continue to grow as a faith and shared history, we have to lend the power of our own history to help them overcome their struggles. And as people say, if you don't learn the past, you are condemned to repeat it, which we see happening in today's American politics. But given the rich history of Jews in New York and the contributions that all the families made to creating this beautiful city, I really can't overstate how vital the work of the Manhattan Jewish Historical Initiative is. You know, I asked a person today, do you know who Isaac Basheva Singer was? And he's 25, and he said, no. And maybe he didn't take that kind of course in college, but this is like an integral part of Jewish history, Upper West Side history, Manhattan history. And so establishing this initiative where people can go to a website, people can go to talks like this, events like this, that they can learn the magnificence and breadth of the Jewish experience in Manhattan. So kicking off this, I think, is a wonderful panel of dedicated people, dedicated Jews. And I thank you, Howard, for putting all of this together.
Let me say to all of you here that if you were to ask me who are my heroes, I would identify these three people for a simple reason. My father taught me years ago, I don't care what kind of Jew you are, just be proud of the Jew that you are. We are privileged to be in the company of three proud Jews. Gabe Pressman, senior correspondent with WNBC. I know you thought it was Chuck Scarborough. It's Gabe Pressman. Joe Berger. Been an editor, writer for the New York Times. How many of you like the New? How many of you don't like the New York Times? All right, see Joe Berger. Let me give you his home number so you can call him. But Joe Berger, again, proud Jew. You like what he writes. Ruth Messinger, I can't say enough about her because what's interesting is she has reminded young people that to be Jewish is to care about your own people and to care about other people. So it is a great honor to be here this evening. Let me just leave you with this thought. There was a magazine for years called Life, right? After Life, I remember there was a magazine called People. After People, it was a magazine called Us. And after Us, there was a magazine called Self. So we started with Life, we went to Self. But we Jews, we read from right to left. So you start with Self, but ultimately, as these three will tell you tonight, it's about us as a people, as a Jewish people, who has done so much to enrich life for those in America. Thank you so much.
So I'm Ruth Messinger. I accepted Howard's invitation to moderate this because I think these are two of the greatest news people ever, any place, who cover New York, who cover Judaism, who cover religion in spectacular ways. And I knew that to do this in my own synagogue would consist of like a few prompts and they should take it away. So this is a sort of also a family story and a connection. All of you know Gabe. Gabe has been at NBC forever, which means that when I was in government, he covered me regularly, but more importantly, he was the place that people in New York City government went to be sure that we knew what the news was, and that what we knew that somebody that we were going to have to deal with on Monday morning was saying on Sunday to Gabe. So he's been called a reporter's reporter. I think that's very true, but he is still reporting, and as he will remind you, I hope in a minute, one of the things that he has covered and still covers is the neighborhoods of New York. Joe Berger, I don't know as well personally, but my mother, as some of you know, did public relations for the Jewish Theological Seminary for 55 years. And I regularly remember sitting in her apartment and in her house in Connecticut and something would happen and she would say, I have to go call Joe Berger. So that's how I got to know Joe Berger. Subsequently wrote a book about the neighborhoods of this city called World in a City. He wrote an extraordinary book, which I hope he'll say a little bit about, called Displaced Persons, which speaks to a piece of his own life experience. And most recently, he's written a book about contemporary Hasidic New York called The Pious Ones. So that's my connection to these two gentlemen. What I'd like you to each to do first for 2 minutes is say something from your own heart about your connection to New York, a piece of your bio, how long you've been here, a piece of what you most love that you've covered about the city, Jewish and otherwise, so people have a little more sense of you as each as a person, and then I have a few questions to ask you. Gabe.
Well, I should start out by recalling how I got into journalism. I was fascinated by newspapers. I used to watch the trucks as they passed the newsstands in the Bronx. And when they threw the papers out, the guy would yell, "Oh!" And somebody would come out and cut the tape or the whatever it was around the newspapers and spread them out. And I decided, with the encouragement of my dad, to start a family newspaper. I had two grandparents and my aunts and uncles. They all lived in the neighborhood in the Bronx, Yankee Stadium area. And he got me this little gadget, which was called, I think, a hectograph. It was just a metal thing with gelatin in it, and you wrote on purple ink and pressed it on the hectograph, and you could get, you know, 10 copies, 20 copies maybe, of something. So I had a family newspaper, and on Shabbos, on the Friday night dinner that we gravitated to, not only my mother and father, but my aunts and uncles, they'd have this newspaper, and it contained such fascinating stuff as Cousin Mark cuts first tooth, or Grandma bakes sponge cake. She uses real sponges. In those days, I didn't realize that accuracy was important and that fantasy was out of the question. But I learned over the years, and I guess that early experience pointed me in the direction that I took in the rest of my life, including 60 years at NBC. Joe?
I came to New York, to the West Side. My parents were refugees from the war in 1950. We lived for a few months at the Capitol Hall on 87th Street, about a block and a half from here. In fact, I luckily found a parking space right near the home. Not easy to do. We lived there for a few months and ultimately got an apartment on 102nd Street and Manhattan Avenue. And my parents sent me to a yeshiva, Manhattan Day School, which is now on 75th Street, but was then at 104th Street. And while I did not end up becoming Orthodox, it certainly gave me a wonderful grounding in Jewish thought, Jewish life, in Hebrew, and in this community, the West Side community, because most of the kids in my class came from the West Side. I went to Bronx Science, and then, which explains why I gave up my Orthodoxy. And then I went to City College, and at City College, I fell in love with a college newspaper, the campus. And many of the journalists you know came through the campus, including Abe Rosenthal and Ralph Blumenthal and Clyde Haberman, and we all came through there. And and so that was my New York experience. We left Manhattan. I was a victim of Robert Moses building housing projects. He tore down the tenement we lived in on 102nd Street. So we ended up in the Bronx, probably near your cousins, near Yankee Stadium, 167th Street.
Right.
So that's my New York. I lived on the West Side for most of my life, but for the last 20 years we live in a suburb of Westchester. So, but we're right now talking about moving back, so
good.
It should happen. Okay.
Good. One of the things I know is that you each covered, from your different perspectives, a gathering of Holocaust survivors who met in Israel about 30 years ago, 35 years
1981.
Ago. 1981. Right. And but many of whom were from New York or had moved to New York or were moving to New York. So how about some comments about that event from each of you, and then we'll go on.
Well, it was convened as a meeting, the first gathering, they called it, of Holocaust survivors. And they came, about 6,000 or so, not only survivors, but their children and grandchildren. and it was a stupendous event. It was unbelievable to see all these people gathered who had suffered, and their children and their grandchildren in some cases. And I remember that vividly, and I remember especially my first visit to Auschwitz, which was actually before that. It was in January 1949, when I was traveling on a fellowship from Columbia. And I went to Auschwitz, and this guy who said he was a survivor, and I believe he was standing out there in the bitter cold, and he became my unofficial guide. He had a big army coat that he had picked up, I guess, from the American Army, and he was shivering as I was, and he showed me the remnants of Auschwitz, the barracks buildings filled with things like women's hair, shoes, suitcases, and I was very, very moved by that, and I had no idea. I was in the Navy in World War II, and I was in the Pacific, and this is my first experience. It was before Auschwitz became generally known, of course, after the war it did, and I remember very, very strongly the emotions I felt. Here I was Jewish, and I was a reporter. I didn't have a newspaper to work for, but I had a small outfit called Overseas News Agency, and I did features for them as I traveled around Europe. But this one just hit me between the eyes, and I had no idea of any of this, of the systematic extermination of my own people. And I remember I was so angry that I had a paper bag, and I put in it some women's hair that still smelled from the gas, Zyklon B, and a baby shoe, which I picked up in a pile at another building, because the Polish government had decided, for whatever reason, not to tear these buildings or this, get rid of this evidence. And I went back to from Poland to Frankfurt in Germany, where there was a press hotel, and I'd left my bags there. And there was an ex-Luftwaffe officer who was the room clerk at this place. And he and I were about the same age. I was about 20, 21. And I dumped the contents of this bag on the reception desk at the hotel, the Park Hotel in Frankfurt. And he looked at me and he said, "We didn't know about these things." And I was very angry. I went from German to German, and finally I poured the contents out in my room, and there was a middle-aged lady, a German lady, who was making up the bed. I dumped the content of this bag of goodies from Auschwitz on the bed, and she started to cry. And it brought me up short, but I did write a letter to my mother, and I'll never forget the words my mother used when she replied to my note. She said, "I don't give a damn what your hatred of the Nazis will do to them. I do care very much what it'll do to you." And that put the brakes on my emotions to an extent. I never forgot, but I didn't feel quite as virulently angry. Anyway, that's a reminiscence.
My folks asked me, they went to this first gathering of Holocaust survivors. Now think about it. It was 1981, and there had not yet been a gathering of Holocaust survivors. This would have been, do the math, about 30 years, 35 years after the war. And the fact is that for couple of decades after the war, people didn't really talk much about what happened during the war. The survivors didn't want to talk about it, and other Jews didn't want to hear about it. Everybody wanted to get on with their lives. And, you know, Elie Wiesel hadn't become Elie Wiesel yet. I don't think they did the film Holocaust yet, or maybe they had just done it a year or so before. So my parents asked me to come with them, and I thought, you know, I'm an American. This is the past. But I was working for Newsday at the time, the Long Island newspaper, and I found a way to. I decided, you know, this is going to be an interesting story. Maybe they'll pony up and send me to Israel for this event, and it changed my life because even before I left for Israel, I began talking to some of the survivors who were going because I knew they were going to do a large story, and suddenly I heard firsthand all these stories that, for whatever reason, I never, you know, asked much about, never asked my parents much about their experiences, never asked my parents' friends about their experience. It was a very, emotional thing in two ways. First, you know, the pain of what people's stories. I mean, we're talking about people who, you know, lost children and lost husbands and wives and whole communities. And they talked about, you know, often very frankly about that. And then to see all these people who are now middle class, able to afford hotels in Jerusalem, would gather in the lounges and laugh about some of the funny experiences they'd been through. Laugh even about painful experiences. It was a kind of a victory statement, you know, that we're still here. You try to wipe us out, but we're still here. So that was a very moving experience for me.
Yes, there were actually 6,000 stories there.
7,000.
7,000, whatever the number, and it was very, very intense. I found that when it started, people seemed a little bit awkward about telling their stories, which is the way they were in the years before this gathering. But then they opened up, and so everybody opened up, and everybody had a story to tell, and they would actually take your arm and say, listen to my story. And of course, it got so that we had to put a cap on it. We couldn't hear every story from all these people. But on the other hand, I agree with you, Joe, that it was an overwhelming experience being at the gathering of Holocaust survivors. And I remember, what Elie Wiesel, whom you referred to before, said, which was, and sort of fit this gathering and what they experienced, the opposite of, I believe I'm quoting correctly, the opposite of love is not hate, it's indifference. Mm-hmm. And obviously the world had been indifferent to the fate of these people, and suddenly, as Joe's just said, they were asserting themselves. And it was a very, very intense, emotional thing for all of us. I did one thing. I asked people, all these people, and many of them gave me the same answer. Did you lose faith that there was a God? And here I am in this sanctuary of God, and I'm telling this story. And almost everybody said they did lose faith, or they didn't, they no longer felt that they could believe in God. And I followed that all the way through until I got to the Prime Minister's office and Menachem Begin, I asked him that question. And I was really stunned by his answer, because he paused for a minute or so. Yes, he said, I still believe in God. He said, because if there wasn't a God, Hitler would have gotten the atomic bomb.
Well, it's interesting that that you say that question, because the two things that are most memorable personally from the gathering was they had a room at the gathering where people could put their information into a computer, a very primitive computer. You can imagine how they were in 1981. And the people would line up so that they could put their basic facts and their relatives who they're still searching for into the computer.
Right.
But people, you know, because they weren't used to the digital age yet, people just put notes on a bulletin board. And my father, who was not a literary man, my mother did all the writing in the family, composed this note, you know, saying, I'm Marcus Berger, I lost six sisters. And he posted them on the wall, sorry.
It's okay. I remember a similar experience in Israel at Yad Vashem, the Holocaust Museum in Jerusalem. And I went into the library section, whatever it was, not the main section where all the exhibits were and the photographs of suffering people, but I was in the archives, so to speak, and there were two women there. They were sisters, they were middle-aged, and they had tears in their eyes. And I said, why do you have tears in your eyes? What have you seen? And they pointed to a book, I guess, or a compilation of the Germans were so organized that they had kept a record of every train and who was on the train, the people who were destined in most cases for death. And these two ladies, who lived in different parts of the United States now, they had found their father and mother's name. Hmm. Okay. And it was so touching, you know. I feel like crying at the memory too.
Yeah.
Joe, maybe we would say something connecting to this story about the book you did on displaced persons, the camp experience, and the number of people, either from that conference or that you covered in the book, that ended up on the West Side. And then we'll let Gabe talk to that as well.
Well, the book is not primarily about the Holocaust as such.
Right.
It's really about what the lives of the refugees were, the Grine, as they called each other, greenhorns, but the Yiddish Grine. It was an interesting, sociologically an interesting group, an interesting time. The survivors mostly hung around each other because, first of all, they spoke Yiddish, and they hadn't yet learned English, and this was much easier to talk to other Grine. And they had certain routines, like they would go for a spazier on Broadway, and they would recognize each other from the camps, be they displaced persons camps or concentration camps, from the Lager, they called them. So the West Side, because of its hotels, that's the only reason I can think of that, because of its hotels, became the center of the refugee population in New York. The Whitehall, the Marseille, I forget which one of those two had a synagogue that my folks sometimes stopped in at. My father, you know, we primarily I think went to Ohab Tzedek, but they stopped in at some of these synagogues where they were all many Grine. You know, they used to love going to Central Park, and they spread a blanket on the grass, and have a picnic with salami sandwiches is what I remember. I remember my father would go with a man named Carol Stranger. That was his name. He used to take care of the brownstones. And in those days, they weren't brownstones. They were, you know, buildings, boarding houses in many cases. You could buy one for nothing. Mr. Stranger, as I used to call him. I used to call all my father's friends, my parents' friends, by Mr. and Mrs. So Mr. Stranger, my father would go to 86th Street, and there were these gymnastic bars that they had there, and they used to do somersaults. And I tell all this because, you know, people always think of the refugees as irredeemably sad and depressed. You know, they were that way at times. How could they not be? But they also managed to eke out some fun, and they managed to try to protect their children and not burden them with their own experience. So, you know, that was the West Side that I remember.
And I remember the Bronx.
Go for it.
My father was a dentist. He was forced into dentistry by his parents, who felt that he had to make a living someday. He was really interested in something else. He wanted to be a magician. And he spent most of his life as an amateur magician, putting on shows, and he loved sleight of hand. He'd be in front of a mirror in the bathroom for hours at a time, practicing making cards do a dance around his fingers or coins. So we were not of refugee stock, although my grandparents had brothers and sisters who perished in the Holocaust. We didn't know that when I was a child, the beginning of my childhood, that they had perished. We found that out later. And of course, it was very traumatic for the old people. But we came from a different generation. I guess my generation, my parents did not experience what your parents did. And I think they were might have been closer to the Holocaust. I wonder whether we could open up something else that you and I have in common. Cardinal John Cardinal O'Connor. You know, the Catholics have a way of putting the cardinal as an exalted rank in the church. They're princes of the church. And so it's the first name, the phrase of the cardinal, and then the last name. Like Timothy Cardinal Dolan is the current cardinal, the current big wheel in the church in New York. And I remember, because of the Holocaust, I had a very close relationship that developed over the years. The flash came out that a bishop named John O'Connor was going to be the new head of the New York Archdiocese. And this guy was the bishop in Scranton, Pennsylvania. So I hopped.
And a Navy man like you.
Yeah, and a Navy man like me. Right. So we had a bond. Went out there to Scranton, and we met for the first time. And I did a long interview with him, which appeared on the following Sunday. But it established a relationship that I've never forgotten. He talked to me about visiting Dachau, one of the camps, and putting his hand in he had the very long fingers, not like mine, putting his hand in the ashes that he found there, and realizing that these had been human beings who had been incinerated. And he was very preoccupied with the Jewish people, and very strongly, he almost adored the Jewish people. And something very unusual happened about a year or two ago. The sister of Cardinal O'Connor down in Pennsylvania, I think near Philadelphia, I went down there to visit her, and she said that Cardinal O'Connor was really, although he didn't know it, was really Jewish. He had a Jewish mother, if you want to interpret it that way, although the mother did convert anyway.
And his grandfather was a kosher butcher.
Really? That part I didn't know.
Right. There's a, if you, the Times reporter Allison Cowan did an amazing genealogical report on Cardinal O'Connor and found tombstones from his mother's father, who had a very Jewish name, I can't remember it right now, but who was a butcher in Bridgeport, I think, in Connecticut.
He didn't know.
They kept it from him. The first time you and I really got to spend time together in a big way was on that trip. I was there for the Times, you were there for NBC. And, well, the trip was, Cardinal O'Connor decided to go to the Middle East, mostly because he was going to visit the Christian communities in Palestine and in Jordan and in Egypt.
That was
his main purpose. But I think
that's what he said his main purpose was. But he really wanted to see the Jews also.
I think he also thought he was going to solve the whole Israeli-Palestinian problem.
Probably.
So he put his foot in his mouth, unfortunately, because at the time the Vatican didn't recognize Israel, and it didn't recognize Jerusalem as the capital of Israel. Most of the world didn't at that time. But he arranged through the church a meeting with Chaim Herzog, I think it was Chaim Herzog, who was president of Israel in Jerusalem. And he got a call from the Vatican saying, you can't do that, because that makes Jerusalem into an official capital of Israel if you go visit him at his president's office. So there was a whole brouhaha. You know, I got a couple of front page stories in the New York Times about it.
Yeah, and
we love brouhahas, right? And it ultimately was settled in a Talmudic or Jesuitical, depending on how you want to put it, manner. They decided that he could, because he was afraid of humiliating the Israelis. On the other hand, he didn't want to flout his Catholic bosses at the Vatican. So they decided to meet Herzog in his home office, which was not an official site in Jerusalem, so that he could go to Jerusalem as long as he didn't do anything official there. So he met Herzog in his home office, and that's how they settled the problem.
Yeah, I remember the frantic phone calls that were going back and forth. Okay. Remember Father McCarthy or Monsignor McCarthy, who was his secretary?
Right.
That was my source.
Right.
He kept telling me that, you know, the latest phone calls from New York, and there were Jewish leaders in New York who were involved too, or certainly advising him. But basically, he was trying to solve this dilemma, you know, his loyalty to the hierarchy in the Vatican, and his presumed affection for the Jewish people and for Israel.
So each of you has spent some time writing about, covering, reporting on New York City neighborhoods. So pick a neighborhood, the last one you wrote about, the first one you wrote about, and just talk about it for a little while.
Well, most recently I wrote about two neighborhoods. Koreatown, which is not really a big neighborhood, it's only one block, West 32nd Street. And the other one was Woodlawn, which is a very tiny neighborhood, about 7,000 people. The Yonkers line with Westchester, it's northeast. It's in the northeast Bronx. And Woodlawn Cemetery is the southern boundary, and Van Cortlandt Park is the western boundary. Anyway, I found it was very interesting that this neighborhood, the Woodlawn neighborhood, was Irish from the get-go. It had been Irish for a long time, and unlike other neighborhoods, I know Joe knows a lot more about this than I do, but most of the neighborhoods in New York are constantly changing. But Woodlawn has not changed, and it has a semi-itinerant Irish population. Some of the Irish people in Woodlawn have gone back home to their counties, County Kerry, County Mayo, and others, and then come back to live in Woodlawn. And Woodlawn has, you know, a few mom-and-pop shops, some pubs, and it was a really a fascinating place. You know, it had me, I've associated enough with Irish people that I can imitate a brogue. Short on it's an unusual place, but anyway.
Well, you know, Woodlawn is one of the last Irish neighborhoods in New York. And of course, when you and I were young children, that the city was full of Irish neighborhoods. But you know, what's happened to the Irish is the same thing that's happened to the Jews and it's happened to the Italians. They you know, worked at blue-collar jobs or white-collar jobs and worked hard to get their kids to go to college. And when the kids went to college, many of them chose to move to the suburbs. So you have Irish suburbs and Italian suburbs or assimilated suburbs. But New York no longer has many of these great Italian and Irish neighborhoods that it once had. So when you find one, and Jewish neighborhoods as well. In fact, you know, when I talked before about growing up in New York, the New York I grew up in had 2 million Jews in it. It's now down to 1 million, according to the according to Federation, the 10-year Federation census. You know, and it's ironic because New York Jews in New York have become more prominent, more powerful, holding various positions in white shoe law firms and in banks that was unheard of back then. On the other hand, they've also shrunk as a percentage of the city. But we were talking about the one group that is on the rise, the Jewish group that's on the rise, of course, are the Orthodox, and particularly the ultra-Orthodox, the right. Hasidim. So here's a plug for my last book. But a neighborhood that you would love to go into and walk around is Borough Park. I say Borough Park because Williamsburg is tends to be much more forbidding, whereas Borough Park is a pretty cool place. They're used to foreigners coming into the neighborhood. And what's interesting about Borough Park is just how much the Hasidic twist on Judaism takes over the neighborhood. You go there at 5 o'clock in the afternoon and the streets are packed with buses. I mean, like you've never seen, because there's so many of the buildings in the neighborhood are schools and synagogues, and every family has 7, 8, 9, 10 children, the schools are packed with kids, and so these buses come and take these kids home, and then when you go there, like on Passover, I could write a whole book on it, and I did, but when you go to the neighborhood in Passover, you see how the Hasidic way of life is so visible there. I had a man named Alex Rappaport show me around, who's a Hasid, and in fact, knows him also. And he took me into a large gourmet supermarket. I think it was called Gourmet Glot. And this was just before Passover, and all the shelves were lined with brown paper because they wanted to make sure nothing, there was no chametz touching anything. And then he showed me, we went to the vegetable section, particularly root vegetables. And he said, you see these two rows of bins, one row over here, one row over here, what's the difference? I said, they look like carrots and parsley and beets to me. He said, take a closer look. And he showed me on the left that the ones on the right were washed and the ones on the left were unwashed. And he said, real Hasidim like to wash their vegetables themselves. This way they make sure that no chametz water ever touches the vegetables. And you know, this kind of intensity, which I could give you many examples of, becomes evident, you know, and you see that the super intensity with which Hasidim go about their religion is very, you know, and something colorful about it too. The kinds of shops they have. So it's really, you know, the silver shops and the shops that sell the men's clothing shops, where they have racks of fabrics, all in various shades of black. In fact, I wish I had called my book 50 Shades of Black. it would have done a lot better.
I'd love to hear each of you talk a little bit about the next 20 years of New York.
It's a great city. It's a sensational city. It's going to prosper. It will continue to attract people from all over the world. It'll change its composition demographically. Obviously, the Hispanic influence will be much greater. And I have faith in the city. I think it's a unique city. And I love this city.
I feel the same way. And I also am very optimistic about the next 20 years in New York. New York today is so much more interesting a place than it was when I was growing up. You know, when you and I were growing, you were, I think, a decade older than me, maybe.
Yeah, I'm much older than you.
Okay. In any case.
I agree with you.
But still, around the time we were young, let's put it at that. You know, there were six ethnic groups in the city. There were Jews, blacks, Italians, Irish, Puerto Ricans were just coming in. It was a very bland kind of, I mean, you know, as I said, it was considered a melting pot, but it was compared to what it is today, where you have 25 ethnic groups,
right?
Many of them with their own neighborhoods.
Yeah, in my neighborhood,
and, you know, you can travel around the city and you can visit foreign countries galore. You know, you go to Richmond Hill and you're in Guyana in South America, and you go to Brighton Beach and you're in Russia, and you go to Rigo Park and you're in Uzbekistan, you know. It's amazing, and you can do it for the cost of a Metro card, you know. So why travel? So, yeah. You know, so because of this...
When I was growing up, I confess that I was once young, and when I was growing up, there were three groups in my neighborhood, that's all. Italians, Irish, and Jews.
Right.
And we didn't get along so well. The Jews got along pretty well with the Italians, but the Irish, they were really, the kids were very nasty. They would occasionally throw stones at us, and we'd throw stones back at them. And then I met John O'Connor many years later, and I became a great fan of Irish people. And I was even before that, but He made a big difference in my life and my understanding of the city and the demographics and the changes.
So now thinking back over your careers, people that you interviewed, I guess I'm going to broaden out a question from the audience. The question from the audience was, like, a couple of the most famous Jews in Manhattan or New York, but I would also like to just hear, like, a couple of the people that you think shaped and defined this city over the time that you were reporting, Jewish or non-Jewish?
Go ahead, Joe.
Well, you know, I think Ed Koch was a key figure, both in the revival of the city and in giving the city its spirit back. After, you remember, we had the fiscal crisis of the 70s, when many people thought the city was doomed, that it would never recover, that it was... it was going to go bankrupt, and crime was going to get out of control, and people would abandon the city, and empty it. Well, that did not happen. So I think Koch was a key figure there, and if I may mention another Jewish mayor, Michael Bloomberg, I think was a key figure in that too, as well as it must be said, Rudy Giuliani, who, you know, whatever we may not like his other brand of politics, but he, you know, he also, I think, pushed that that revival along as well.
Yeah, my favorite mayor in many ways was Robert Wagner, the son of the senator who was behind much of the New Deal legislation of FDR, and a very smart man. He was of Germanic background, of course, Wagner, and he had an ability to sit tight in all situations, driving people crazy. Many, you know, like there'd be a big strike, paralyzing strike. He'd invite them to Gracie Mansion, and he'd put the management people in one room and the labor people in another room, and he'd drive them nuts because he was so stolid and determined, and yet, in a way, a very conciliatory guy. He just understood human emotions, and he was very important to the growth of the city, even though he was regarded as a very dull man. He was not dull at all. He was very smart.
That's good. I like that. So I would like you now to each ask a question of the other.
Uh-oh. You want to go first, or do you want me to go?
You go first. Age, go ahead.
Do you think that in the course of your career, you developed any insights into humanity?
None.
Okay, I'll take the question.
What about you? Have you developed any insights into humanity?
Yeah, I think that if you look into somebody's eyes, like I'm looking into yours, and you ask a question, you're bound to get a better answer than if you pick up the telephone and try to ask the question that way.
Absolutely.
Or if you wait for somebody to give you the information as to what that guy said. That's not journalism. Journalism is man to man, man to woman, person to person. Without that spark in your eyes and in his or hers, there's not really great communication.
Well, I was going to take off, actually, if I was being flip before, but I'll take off from something you said. One of the things I've discovered as a reporter is what you said about the survivors and when you interviewed them in Jerusalem. Everybody wants to tell their story, not just the survivors. Everybody's got a story, and people really want to tell their story. Whether they trust you to tell their story is another thing, but people want to be known. And I think it has immeasurably helped me in my career because I found people who did want to be known. And I think even those who seem to put up a wall really want to be known, but maybe are afraid to let people know them. So
that
I think we've been lucky in that sense.
You know? I experienced that today. I went down to Holy Apostles Church at 28th Street and 9th Avenue, and I interviewed some of the people who were, they were hungry and they were being fed. There's quite a large crowd of people who were striving desperately to make ends meet. And I couldn't find anyone at first who was willing to talk to me, certainly not on camera. And then suddenly, this one guy said, "I'll talk to you," and he opened up and he talked very much about what he regards as the spirit of Christmas and how it's gone from the city, and he went on and on. It was quite a sudden, you know, intervention by somebody, maybe somebody up above, but I finally found someone to talk. And then I found other people who looked me in the eye and talked. It was very hard to do. You know, these people are very, very poor. They're striving desperately to survive, and you want to talk to them. But I felt it was important to do this story, which really, I started the story in my backyard at NBC, 30 Rockefeller Plaza, people shopping at Saks and the bustle and the glitter of the holiday, the Christmas holiday. And then you go down to this church, and actually I didn't do it in that order. I did the church first. But then you show people the church and the people standing online and being fed turkey and mashed potatoes, you know, the best meal they're gonna have all day, and they only serve 5 times a week, you know, 5 days a week. So you can always get close to somebody if you start talking to them. In this case, it's pretty tough. You have a whole church full of people who are not very happy about their lives, and they are suspicious. Some of them maybe have had served time. They don't want to talk to anybody and go on camera, you know, most of them. It's quite a sales job you have to do. But I think the best way to do it is to look at them.
And to ask.
And to ask, and to do it politely, and stay away from anyone who's got problems.
You asked before about important New Yorkers we've known. You're one of the important New Yorkers.
That's not what I was looking for.
I'm sorry, you know, you were in the forefront of many of the great changes that made New York the benevolent city it is, and I think that needs to be known.
Thank you. I like where the two of you ended up a minute ago, because this is the evidence that journalism and reporting is how we really learn our history, how we share our stories, and how we actually know what's happening in the city in which we live. And we've been treated to some reminiscences from two of the most important journalists of the last 50 years. Thank you.